Not really quiet. How you guys doing this morning? Great. Missing some people. What's everybody? I guess they're sleeping in. They're going to watch online, right? I'm going to check the online Facebook thing to see who all's watching, because we know. But I'm glad you guys are here. We got some visitors this morning. And of course, everyone that's here every week, so good to see you all. We're glad to be back. I guess we didn't even miss a Sunday, but we were traveling all week to Georgia to visit our families. But glad to be back and see all you smiling faces out there. But for now, let's stand. We're going to worship. We're going to sing. Hallelujah. Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, oh hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, oh hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Your love is surprising, I can feel it rising. All the joy that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this God song rising up in me. Hallelujah, come on now. Hallelujah, oh hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
One more time.
Your love makes me sing. Stay standing for the reading of the Word of God. This is 1 Peter 5, 6, and 7. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he may exalt you at the proper time, casting all your cares on him, because he cares about you.
Good morning. I'm going to ask you to sit for just a second. As many of you have doubtless been watching news this week, and you have been agonizing and troubled over the events that have rocked our nation, and I felt it would be appropriate for us as this part of God's body to take just a minute or two in our worship service this morning and pray for our nation. Because whatever side you're on, whatever your political persuasion, there should be no doubt that we need to seek God's face for our nation. And so I'm going to invite you to pray. If you're able to and want to, you can kneel. You humble yourself before the Lord that way. Otherwise, you can just stay where you are if that's where you're more comfortable. But spend just a moment or two just earnestly seeking the Lord for our nation. Would you pray? Father God, we humble ourselves before you this morning. And we ask, Lord, fully believing that you are powerful enough to meet the challenges that lay before us, that you are caring enough to want to do something about them. And Father, we ask that you would take all of the horrible things that face our nation, the uncertainty, the turmoil, the violence, and everything else that's set before us, Lord, and that you would apply your presence, that you would work in such a way that this would be a time that nationally caused this nation to turn their eyes back toward you. And we pray, Lord, that there would be a great awakening in this land, that hearts and minds of men, women, and children would be transformed, that the gospel would take root, that characters would be changed, and that as a whole, that this people would seek your face, and that you would truly, truly, Lord, heal not just this land, but our spirits and our hearts. Lord, we believe in your power. We believe in your goodness. And Lord, we ask these things with full confidence of knowing that you are already working ahead of us to answer them. And Father, as we have gathered here to worship today, we pray for these moments that we lift our voices in song and praise, Lord, that you would lift our hearts, lift our minds, focus us on worship instead of worldly concerns, and transport us, Lord, into your presence for these moments. We ask these things in Jesus' name, and all God's people said,
amen. Let's stand.
You hear me when I call, you are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles leave me still, who shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. My strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me, yours is the victory. Who shall I fear? Who shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Again, this is the air I breathe.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air.
Yeah. receive grace at the sound of your praise. The fatherless, they find their rest at the sound of your praise. The sick are healed. There's nothing worth more than we'll ever come close. Nothing can compare your living hope. Oh, your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord.
Raise your voice, church.
Holy Spirit, you are more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence.
Our way.
As you open your copy of God's Word this morning, we're going to be finding Numbers chapter 27 and also Deuteronomy chapter 31. Those are books you don't turn to real often in a sermon, aren't they? In 1787, a very uncertain George Washington was considering whether or not he should seek the newly established office of the President of the United States of America. He was urged by many people that he should be the one to seek that first office, but the very first person who argued really persuasively and probably ultimately convinced him that he should become president was Governor Morris of Pennsylvania, who had been a delegate to the Constitutional Convention. Governor Morris was concerned that if somebody else was put in charge, that it would spell disaster for the newly formed United States, and there would be increased opposition to the ideals of the fledgling republic. And he simply did not trust anyone else to be able to do the job rightly. And so Morris wrote a letter to Washington, and I've got that slide up there so you can see what he wrote to him as I read it. He said that your cool, steady temper is indispensably necessary to give a firm and manly tone to the new government. No constitution is the same on paper and in life. The exercise of authority depends upon personal character. And that was written on October 30th, 1787. And there is a lot of wisdom in those words. The exercise of authority depends upon personal character. It is incredibly easy for unscrupulous people who hold much power to use that power for personal gain or to advance their own agendas without considering how that affects those that they wield the power over. I think we have more than enough examples from history to prove the validity of that sentiment. But if I could twist the very last part of that quote just a bit from what Governor Morris originally said, I think it would be even more truthful for us to say that the right exercise of authority depends upon godly character. This morning, we are embarking on a new series of messages in which we are going to follow the exploits of a leader of truly godly character who exercised the authority that had been placed within him in a way that reflected God's glory and in a way that pointed people toward him. He's one of the great figures of the Old Testament, even though He's sometimes eclipsed a little bit by the people that are surrounding him. His name is Joshua. And I'm going to be real honest with you here this morning. I wrestled with what message to bring to you this morning. I had not planned to begin I had this on my calendar to do, but I had not planned to bring this series quite yet. But after the events of this week, I thought, what could I say to bring comfort and hope after the events that have rocked our nation? Not just in a week, but for months, we have been in chaos and turmoil. And every time I keep coming back to Joshua, because there are a lot of things here that I think will really resonate with where we are in modern times. There was, when Joshua came on, there was a change in leadership of a nation. There was a time of upheaval and change as the whole nation left what was familiar and moved out into an unknown future. There was a time of uncertainty as their faith was tested, and even a time of violence as they moved into the promised land and had to take possession of what God said was theirs. And I think that what God had to teach to Joshua and the people, I think is very timely for us to hear right now. And so we're going to go ahead and do Joshua a little bit earlier than intended. The book that bears his name is the sixth book in the Bible, but its content is very closely entwined with the events that are recorded in Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And in fact, you're going to see Joshua's name popping up throughout all of those books. And as we follow his adventures, we're gonna find some important principles that I hope will help us to grow into the kind of faith and spiritual maturity that Joshua so often displayed. That's the kind of faith that will help us to move into our own future with strength and courage and confidence. Now, as we get started, let me give you just a little bit of background on this man of God before we get into today's text. Even though Joshua is a Hebrew, he was born and raised in Egypt. He grew up as a slave, and he had no real reason to expect that anything was going to be any different in his life. So imagine his surprise when he is in his 20s, and the prince of Egypt that had been in exile in a foreign land because he had committed murder, and now comes back and says that God had heard the prayers of his people and had sent Moses back to lead them out of bondage. And so there is Joshua, a very young man, suddenly given hope that things will be different. And Joshua got to be an eyewitness to the events that followed Moses' proclamation to Pharaoh to let his people go. That means that he was there when all of the 10 plagues were descending upon Egypt and eventually forced Pharaoh to relent. Joshua was there when they stood on the banks of the Red Sea, certain that they were all going to die. And then God parted the waters before them. Joshua was there to see the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud that led them out into the wilderness. He experienced firsthand the provision of the Lord as he gave manna to feed his people in the wilderness. You could say that Joshua's character and his ability to depend upon the Lord was forged in the crucible of the Exodus as he learned this important lesson. The Lord would never let him down. Joshua was also blessed to have an incredible mentor in the person of Moses. He was there and able to see Moses stand strong against enemies without and critics from within. And he saw how he led the people in accordance with the Lord's desires instead of trying to follow his own agendas. But even as he was watching Moses as his mentor, Joshua wasn't just a spectator. His natural abilities coupled together with his growing faith in the Lord caused him to get noticed often, and he began to be given positions of authority among the people. As a matter of fact, one of the very first major challenges that the people of Israel had to face after they left Egypt was to face an army of Amalekites that decided that they were going to come and do what the Egyptians couldn't. They were going to wipe the Hebrews out. And Joshua was given command of their fledgling forces. He led them into battle, and there again, he got to see the Lord bring victory in a supernatural way. Now, it was one more thing for him to add to the very long list of reasons he had to trust the Lord. So here we are. Joshua started as a slave. He became a general. And after a time, he also became a spy. And you'll find that out in Numbers chapter 13. Whenever 12 men were chosen to be spies to go into the promised land to spy it out and see what path they needed to take possession of it. And you'll remember how that story went, that the spies went out into the land. They came back. 10 of them said, no way, no how, ain't going to happen. We can't do it. But 2 of the men said, yeah, let's go. The Lord's got this. We can do it. Joshua was one of those 2 men who were ready to defy the things that they could see with their eyes because the Lord told him it was theirs, and they believed. They believed that he would be able to bring victory over a seemingly unbeatable foe. And really, why should Joshua have thought anything different? Everything in his experience has led him to believe that the Lord was powerful enough to overcome any challenge that came against his children. So after that, Joshua became Moses' personal assistant, and ultimately, Joshua became Moses' successor. Now that's not a bad ride for a slave kid that was born in the slums of Egypt's slave district, is it? Now, just a couple more things about Joshua before we look at his commissioning in today's text. First, Joshua was not always his name. His name originally was Hoshea, which means salvation. During the events of the Exodus, however, Moses changed his name to Joshua, which instead of just meaning salvation, means that Yahweh saves. So he's saying the Lord saves. Now, names are important things in the Bible, especially when a name gets changed. Do you remember when the Lord changed Abram's name to Abraham? Remember when Simon the disciple became Peter the rock? Remember when the Pharisee Saul of Tarsus became Paul the apostle? Why did they get name changes? Because it signified something important happened. Names were not changed in the Bible just on a whim. They were changed to mark significant change or new beginning. So Joshua changed dramatically from the man that he had been into the man that God called to lead his people. In his life, this man moved from being Hoshea, which is kind of a general, nebulous, wishful longing for salvation, into being Joshua, a man who has seen with his own eyes that God keeps his promises and has saved his people. By the way, it's also interesting to note that Joshua is a Hebrew name. Does anybody know what the Greek version of Joshua is? Anybody? Jesus is the Greek version. So in many ways, Joshua can be seen as a foreshadowing of the promised Messiah. The other thing about Joshua is that whenever it came time for him to take over from Moses, it was not the people that chose him. The Lord chose Joshua to lead Israel after Moses. There was no election. There was no search committee. There was no wrangling over who was the most qualified or popular. The Lord is the one who said, this is the way it's going to be. And there was no way that the Lord was going to let leadership of his people at this crucial juncture become nothing more than a popularity contest. Because the people have already shown numerous times that they have a skewed idea of what they needed in a leader. They would certainly have picked the wrong man to be their leader if they were left to their own devices. So the Lord moved quickly and decisively to appoint a leader that would not only be capable of leading in a battle, but that a leader would also be there to lead them spiritually along the right path. Joshua was his man. And now, having said all that, I want you to find Numbers 27, and let's look at what God said that he was supposed to do with Joshua, that Moses was supposed to do with him. Numbers 27, verse 15. So Moses appealed to the Lord. May the Lord, the God who gives breath to all, appoint a man over the community who will go out before them and come back in before them, and who will bring them out and bring them in, so that the Lord's community won't be like sheep without a shepherd." The Lord replied to Moses, "Take Joshua, son of Nun, a man who has the Spirit in him, and lay your hands on him. Have him stand before the priest Eleazar and the whole community and commission him in their sight. Confer some of your authority on him so that the entire Israelite community will obey him. He will stand before the priest Eleazar, who will consult the Lord for him with the decision of the Urim. He and all the Israelites with him, even the entire community, will go out and come back in at his command." Moses did as the Lord commanded him. He took Joshua, had him stand before the priest Eleazar, and the entire community, laid his hands on him and commissioned him as the Lord had spoken through Moses. I want you to notice in verse 18 in particular, something that was said here about Joshua. It said that he had the Spirit in him. Joshua was full of the Holy Spirit. Now, why is that meaningful? It's particularly so because we remember that we are reading the Old Testament, not the New. This is long, long, long before the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit fell upon the believers. And we know that after the day of Pentecost, that the Holy Spirit is a constant indwelling force in every believer. And we almost take it for granted that God's Spirit is with us always. In the Old Testament, things worked differently. In the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit came to certain key people at important times to empower them to do the Lord's work. Just read through, for instance, like the prophets, it'll say, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon such and such, and they did this, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon such and such, and the Spirit would come, and then the Spirit would depart after that task was finished. So this description of Joshua tells us something really important. It shows us that Joshua was the Lord's man, chosen in the Lord's time, empowered by the Lord's Spirit to bring the Lord's people into the land of promise. Joshua was not doing this for fame or glory. He was not in it for the accolades. Oh my goodness, he's watched all these years of the people tearing down Moses. He had no illusions about what leading this people was going to be like. So he didn't do it for the accolades. He didn't do it because he thought he was going to get rich. He was doing the Lord's work, period. The Lord's fingerprints were all over this man's character. And that showed itself in a consistent faithfulness that was evident to anyone who cared to look at his life. Now, what we just read, that was the Lord's instructions to Moses to commission Joshua. That commissioning is also recorded in Deuteronomy 31. And this is actually what the Lord has had Moses speak to Joshua in his commissioning. Look there with me. Deuteronomy 31, verse 7. "Moses then summoned Joshua and said to him in the sight of all Israel, 'Be strong and courageous, for you will go with this people into the land the Lord swore to give to their ancestors. You will enable them to take possession of it. The Lord is the one who will go before you. He will be with you. He will not leave you or abandon you. Do not be afraid or discouraged.'" Joshua is given a very clear mandate. Whereas his ancestor Abraham had been called to live in the promised land, Joshua is now called to possess the promised land. Those that had usurped Israel's place during their captivity would be driven out, and God would keep the promise that he had made to Abraham to give the land to his descendants. Now, let's break this commission down just a bit. There are three main parts to what the Lord told Joshua he's supposed to do. The first thing he said is that Joshua be strong and courageous. Now, hasn't Joshua already proven himself to be strong and courageous? When you think about everything he's gone through in his life, what he has done, of course he's been strong and courageous. So why would Moses, and God through Moses, why would he say this to him now? Well, I don't think he was trying to insult him or his courage. Moses knew, and the Lord knew, that Joshua was going to be tested in ways that were unfamiliar to him. He was going to face a whole new set of pressures. He is not now the right-hand man. He is now the focus of everyone's attention. His faith was going to be stretched and tried as he passed through both incredible victories and devastating defeats. You know, if you watch people, you realize that they can be incredibly courageous in some areas and incredibly cowardly in other areas. For example, I have seen some folks that have gone through, say, cancer treatments. And they have gone to every surgery, every chemo treatment, every bit of radiation, and they have done it all without batting an eye, with steely-eyed determination, because you got to do what you got to do. And they faced it like champions. But you let them see a spider, and they're ready to burn the house down to get rid of that thing. And, you know, they just freak out. Champions in one arena, cowards in another. And that's kind of where Joshua was, is that he had proven himself to be a champion in this arena over here, but now he is going to be tested and his courage is going to have to find a new form over here. He was going to need new reserves of strength and courage, reserves that he had never tapped into before. There were certainly going to be days when Joshua felt weak. There were going to be days, no matter how courageous he was, there were going to be days when the cold clutches of cowardice would grasp his heart. And he needed to be on guard against those times so that they did not gain a foothold in his life. The reality is that for all of us, there come times when our preparations are insufficient, when our strength is not enough, when our knowledge and wisdom fail us. And like Joshua, we need to hear the Lord whisper in our ears, "Be strong and courageous." And when you hear the Lord whispering that in your ear, it gives you a fresh sense of purpose, a fresh sense of confidence, a fresh sense of courage to meet the challenge that's in front of you. So he told Joshua, "Be strong and courageous." He also told him that he was supposed to lead the people to properly possess the promise. It says that he will go into the land with the people, that he was going to take them with him. There are some translations that said he was supposed to go in and divide the land among the people. He was supposed to make sure that it happened in an orderly fashion, the way that the Lord had designed it to go. The people of Israel were diverse in their opinions. They were diverse in their temperaments. They didn't agree on much most of the time. And I imagine that leading them, I kind of use this phrase about being a pastor and trying to lead a church. It's like herding a bunch of cats. Have any of you tried to get a group of cats together and make them go the same direction? If so, how does that work out for you? Probably not very good. Because why? Because this one's going to be lying over here. That one's going to disappear somewhere. The other one's going to go a different direction. They're just going to do what they want to do. And people are a lot like that. They're just going to do what they want to do. If they had gone into the promised land like that, so diverse in opinion, so divided, with so many conflicting agendas, then their entry into the promised land would have turned into an unmitigated disaster. The people needed leadership. Because without that, even if they had managed to win, they would have started fighting amongst themselves over who got the best stretch of land. Israel would have degenerated into nothing more than a bunch of isolated city-states at war with one another. And God's plan to establish a nation that would eventually lead to the Messiah would have been stalled at the very beginning. Joshua's leadership stopped that from happening. The people needed a leader of godly character to guide them in their possession of the promise to avoid the chaos that would have otherwise consumed them. Third thing he told them, he told Joshua, don't be afraid or discouraged. Joshua was human. You better believe there were times when he was afraid. You better believe there were times when he was discouraged. This wasn't a failing on his part. This is simply the way life is. We all feel that way sometimes. What Moses is telling him here, this is not a condemnation of a natural feeling. These instead were words of encouragement for when those feelings did come. When you feel afraid, when you feel discouraged, remember what the Lord has said. Trust his promise and his power to overcome those things that are threatening to shake your emotional equilibrium. Fear and discouragement are the biggest obstacles to any endeavor, whether it's to achieve something in a mundane life or whether it's to achieve a spiritual goal and success there. Fear and discouragement will stand in your way. The remedy to fear and discouragement is God's presence and the confidence that it brings. That's where the really neat part of Joshua's commission comes in. He's given this daunting list of tasks to do, but he's not left to his own devices to get them accomplished. He's given his tasks, and then he is reassured with a twofold promise. He says, verse 8, the Lord is the one who will go before you. The Lord will go ahead of you, Joshua. You are walking into territory that he has already passed over. That means there is nothing here to surprise him. There is nothing here that you need to ultimately be afraid of. There is nothing here that should make you so discouraged that you think that all hope is lost. He's got this, Joshua. He has gone before you. Do you know that he's got this, church? Do you know that long before we ever heard of COVID-19 or election drama or any of the other stuff we're worried about, God had already walked over this land? He knows all about national turmoil. He knows all about nations abandoning him and turning to evil. He knows all about being discouraged. He knows about being sick of it all. He knows that feeling of being alone and helpless before a monumental problem. He goes before you. We don't get too many really deep snows down here. We're a little bit too far south. Some of you are even further south, and the least little dusting of snow freaks you out. But I'm from a little bit further north, where we got regularly quite a bit of snow. And the thing about after you get a big snowstorm, you go out and you walk out to clear off the car, and it's kind of difficult, because you are trudging through that snow, and just the mere act of walking is like 10 times more difficult than it should ordinarily be. But whenever you turn around to go back in the house, you're able to put your feet back in the holes that you have already made in the snow. And it's much, much easier because the trail has already been broken for you. The Lord goes before us. When we put our feet where he has prepared a spot for them to go, it's going to make our walk with him much, much easier. So he told them, he will go before you. He also told Joshua, he said, he will be with you. He will not leave or abandon you. Do you know that failure is not in God's nature? It's just not part of his character. When God says something, you can depend on it. He gave Joshua very clear instruction. He said, "Do this and I will provide the victory. You walk the path I've laid out in front of you, and you never have to worry that you're lost, because I am right here with you." As long as Joshua followed the Lord, he had nothing to worry about. Now, that doesn't mean it's easy. That doesn't mean there aren't going to be any challenges or that he's not going to have bad days. But it means that he has the ultimate confidence that if he is following the Lord, that eventually it's going to be okay. Even if it doesn't feel like it today, even if it doesn't feel like it tomorrow, eventually we're going to get there, because the path that he is leading us on is not going to lead us to defeat. The path he leads us is going to lead us to victory. There is a confidence that comes when you are assured of the Lord's presence in your life. You are willing to risk much more. You are willing to do much more. You are willing to endure much more when you know that you have the right backup with you along the way. He said, "Joshua, I will be with you." If he were around today, he might say, "Joshua, I've got your back. I'm going to be there every step of the way. You can count on me." And so he was for Joshua, and so he will be for us when we follow him. As we stand here this morning at the beginning of Joshua's journey, we need to ask an important question. What relevance does the life of a man who lived thousands of years ago in a different culture on the other side of the earth, what possible relevance does this have to me? Well, you can learn a lot by studying people like Joshua, because the Lord does not change. The Lord's character at the time of Joshua is the same as his character today. That means that when we see the principles God puts into place in the lives of people like Joshua, we can then carry those same principles forward into our own lives. Now, while this particular promise is very narrowly focused on Joshua, we can nevertheless look at the principles behind those promises, and we can draw enormous truth from them. And I think here this morning, the things that we have talked about, we can take away from them several important principles. The first is this: we can be strong and courageous. We can. We don't have to be victims. We don't have to be at the mercy emotionally of every little disaster that happens, big or small. We can be strong and courageous. What is it this morning that is threatening to turn you into a coward? What is it in your life that is making you feel weak and timid? The Lord wants to help you face those things and overcome them. He wants to give you the ability to move forward and achieve the calling that he has placed upon your life. He does not call you to defeat and despair. He calls you to follow him, knowing that that path only leads to goodness. We can be strong and courageous. Second thing I think we can draw from this: that to every one of us, God says, be a leader. Be a leader. Not everyone can be in charge, but everyone can be a leader. Lead your friends. Lead your family, your coworkers, by being a positive, steady, faithful, godly influence in their lives. Your godly character expressed in your daily life will be an influence that can help guide others to the Lord. Your willingness to follow the Lord, it can always be an inspiration that can lead those who see it and commit themselves anew to following him. And the least little thing can make a dramatic impact in someone's heart. The least little act of spiritual leadership on your part can build into the lives of the people around you things that will become a bedrock of their own character. You know, my grandma Ruth, one of my very first memories of her is standing at the kitchen sink washing dishes, singing hymns. And I remember that. She was one of the first examples of a Christian that I ever saw in my young life. And it made a difference to me. Now, she never would have dreamed that singing a hymn to herself over the kitchen sink would make a difference. It did. You can make a difference. Be intentional about it. Be the example that you wish you had had. Third thing we can draw off this morning. Don't let discouragement take root in your heart. Just as God does not call his people to defeat, neither does he call them to despair. Sometimes you will feel down. That is a fact of the human condition. Even the most relentlessly optimistic among us have down days. What we need to watch out for is that we do not allow that negativity to rule our emotions and to turn our hearts away from the joy of the Lord. In your darkest moments, remind yourself of the Lord's presence and his promises. You are a child of the King. You have been saved and sanctified and given life eternal. You have been filled with the Holy Spirit and empowered not just to live, but to thrive in the Lord's service. You have been promised strength. You have been given hope. You have been promised that justice will come. You have been promised a peace that passes understanding. You have been promised so many things, and God has proven he's a promise keeper. Now, I know that doesn't change the reality of pain in your heart. It doesn't change the reality of the struggle with the bad thoughts and emotions that sometimes are swirling around in our heads. But neither does that struggle with the bad stuff, neither does that change the realness of what God is doing in us and through us. He is at work in the life of everyone who loves and follows him. That's the truth. Whether you feel it or not, that's the truth. Follow him, yes. But don't just plod along with your head down and acting like it's never going to get any better. Follow him, but also trust him. Believe, really believe that he keeps his promises to you. And lastly, I think that we can learn really that he will never leave us or abandon us. Isn't that good news? Jesus repeated a version of these words after the resurrection as he was preparing to ascend into heaven. He said, "I am with you always, even to the end." You know what this means? God is never going to run out on you. God is never going to get disgusted with you enough to throw you out of his kingdom. He is never going to disappear when you need him. He will be with you always. Whatever you're facing, he is there, and he gives you every tool that you need to get through it and find joy on the other side. Like Joshua, let's follow the Lord. Let's trust him. Let's be strong and courageous in the face of this tumultuous time in which we live. Let's not be people of discouragement or despair or defeat. Let us be people of confidence and courage that lead the way into a better tomorrow. Would you pray with me? Father, this morning, we ask that you would fill us with the confidence of your presence. Lord, as we have struggled with whatever challenges are in front of us that have rocked us to our core, Lord, this morning, reveal to us the strength that you have already made available. Reveal to us, Lord, how to look with new eyes and look at those things differently with a sure knowledge that you've got it under control. And Lord, as we stand here at the beginning of Joshua's time, I pray that you would fill us with the same sense of optimism that he must have felt, the same sense of excitement as the promise was about to become reality. May we, Lord, get just a taste of that glory. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning, as we do each week, we invite you to come and kneel here at the altar if the Lord has challenged you today. Maybe there's one of those places where you're feeling weak and you need some fresh strength. You come and kneel here at the front and the Lord will give you that. Or you can pray right where you are as well. If you need someone to pray with you, I'll be right over here to the side. You come and grab me on your way up. Whatever he has called you to, whatever he's challenged you for, whatever decision he wants you to make, this is your opportunity to respond to him. Would you please stand as we sing?
Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the wine from thy wounded side which flow be of sin the not the labor of my hands can fulfill thy laws demands. Could my zeal no respite know? Could my tears forever flow? All for sin. While I draw his fleeting breath, when my eyes shall close in death, when I soar to worlds unknown, see thee on thy judgment throne, Rock of ages, cleft for me.
Love that last verse. How about you? That's great. Be seated for just a second. Have a couple of announcements for you before we close our service. I often forget to announce that because we are not taking up an offering because of COVID, that there is a box over there by the door that you can leave your gifts in. But I really don't feel like I need to tell you much because you all do a really good job of that. Through COVID, we have done a fantastic job, people have, of keeping up with their giving. And that's been a blessing to the ministry of this church, right? Oh, this one makes me sad. Good, it's time to take down the Christmas decorations. I mean, if it were me, I'd leave them up all year because I love them. But it's a little bit seasonally disproportionate to do that. So we're going to be starting on that project tomorrow. Anybody that can be here at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning, we are going to begin taking things down. We would appreciate help if you can be here to assist with that. Many hands make light work. And so hopefully we can get that done in a very timely fashion. Shirts. The OMCC shirts that we have ordered are on the table right over there. If you ordered one and have not yet picked up yours, make sure that you do that this morning. And also, I know that there were several people that after the fact wished that they had ordered one or they hadn't known about it or whatever. We did get in some extras, so it's possible that if you want one, didn't order one, it's possible we might still have some in your size over there. So you can see Anne up here, and she will be happy to hook you up with that. All right, any other announcements this morning? All right, seeing none, stand back up. And let's pray. Our Father, we thank you this morning for letting us be in your house. And we pray, Lord, that you would take the things that we have learned, the warm feeling of worship that we have shared, and help us, Lord, to take those things with us out into this world and make a difference. Pray you bless us now in Jesus' name. Amen.